nature, scope and meaning of zoology. Nature, scope and meaning of zoology. The biology is a science devoted to the study of living organism. Biology is means bio means life. So it's about life. It's about the living organism. The science progressed by breaking down complex subjects into their component parts. So today, there are numerous branches of zoology, which immediately we divided them into botany, zoology, and microbiology. That immediate branches of biology are botany, zoology, and microbiology. Botany is about the study of plants, and zoology is about the study of animals, and particularly about the microorganisms like bacteria, virus. What do you say that course with that subject we say? Microbiology. These are the principal and heterogeneous and divergent groups of biology. The principal, heterogeneous, divergent groups of biology are botany, zoology, and microbiology. Zoology, in zoology, what is zoon? Zoon means animal, logos, knowledge, or study. That means it is an animal science, that is a study of animals. It is a part of the biological science which deals with the study of various aspects of animals. Starting from the sponges, that means from the phylum Porifera to the last, the phylum Chordata. In the phylum Chordata, the last one, that is mammalia. Okay. So the aim of zoology is to explain the animal world in terms of scientific principles. The aim of zoology is to explain the animal world in the terms of scientific principles. Zoology is studied as a pure science, that knowledge gaining, and it has application in other branches. As a pure science, you may read it as, but it has so many applications, like such as euphonics, eugenics, biotechnology, bioenergetics, bioinformatics, likewise. Let us see one after another. Let us see eugenics. We know what is genetics, isn't it? Genetics. Genetics means study of inheritance and variation. And in genetics, I already said to you that we did a human genome project. They read the total genes of, decoded the total genes and chromosomes of the human being. The project we started in 1990 and completed in 2003. Now each and every gene and their sequencing and their sequence characters, everything we know. So what we do with this, that by the knowledge of genetics, what we do, what we can do, that we can go for the treatment of different kinds of disorders, genetic disorders. So that is eugenics. What is eugenics? Eugenics is the application of knowledge of genetics for the human welfare. Eugenics is the application of knowledge of genetics. Application of knowledge of genetics for human welfare. Nowadays, you may add over that the vaccination, that all that particular vaccination. For vaccination, what is required? RNA genome is required. That means COVID-19 we are discussing. That RNA genome is decoded actually. So decoded for what? For human welfare. That knowledge of genetics for human welfare. What do you say? Eugenics. That means not only viruses, everything. That means the various aspects we are using, DNA fingerprinting, forensic science. These are all applications of knowledge of genetics even. And we are understanding the patterns of inheritance in the people, all these when we use in the for human welfare, we call it as eugenics. Euphonics, similar science. Here also we use the application of knowledge of genetics, particularly that euphonics is for genetic disorders, symptomological genetic disorders. Application of genetics knowledge for genetic disorders like hemophilia, color blindness, that various kinds of diseases are there, DMD, Duchenne muscular dystrophy, the Klinefelter syndrome, Turner syndrome. We'll list out all the diseases when we go to the second year genetics chapter. That euphonics, what is euphonics? Treatment for the genetic disorder, using the knowledge of genetics for the genetic disorder. We say it as applied science. What is pure science? Pure science gives the knowledge. That is zoology. So with this knowledge, what we can do? What we can do? We can apply. We can apply for human welfare. We can apply for the diseases of the human being, for the treatment of the diseases of the human being. So we say eugenics and euphonics. So that to be remembered. Eugenics, application of knowledge of that genetics for the human welfare, we say eugenics. And symptomological treatment for the genetic disorder, the science which explains, which helps for the treatment of the genetic disorder, we call euphonics. Okay. Next, biotechnology. Biotechnology, using the knowledge of biology, particularly microbiology, using that microbial organisms for the human welfare in the industrial aspect. We have a separate chapter, biotechnology. Recombinant DNA technology we are going to learn in biotechnology and applications of the biotechnology also. The similar way, bioenergetics, all these are said to be bioinformatics. That what you say, all these are applied sciences. Okay, bioinformatics, bioenergetics, biotechnology, eugenics, euphonics, all we say the branches which are newly formed because of the knowledge of biology, knowledge of zoology. Then as an applied science, it has tremendous scope in agriculture. Then aquaculture. Aquaculture, agriculture, I think we know that agriculture, the culture of plants, aquaculture, the culture of fishes, all aquatic organisms, fishes, prawns, crab, whatever, eatable, edible, everything, edible culture. We say edible aquatic organisms. When we do culture, we say aquaculture. Animal husbandry. Dairy farm, poultry farm, that all will come. Apiculture, that sericulture. Okay, we'll discuss. Human health aspect, human health and diseases. Veterinary science, that apiculture, specially given apiculture. That culture of, part of animal husbandry, that the apiculture. The culture of honeybee, we say apiculture. Culture of honeybee is called apiculture. Okay. The culture of silk moth, silk worm, there's a difference actually, that no matter at present, that silk moth. Silk worm means larva, silk moth means adult. So that culturing them is said to be sericulture. That is for the production of silk. Okay. Apiculture, which means honeybee, then sericulture, which means the culture of silk moth. Pharmacology, medicine, animal breeding, the breeding of various kinds of animal, dairy breeding, poultry breeding, likewise. Okay, so that all we'll discuss. We have separate chapters for all of them, just an introduction. Nature, scope and meaning of zoology is given here like this. Okay, so then this is about the nature, scope and meaning of let's start. The need for classification. 1.4, need for classification. Then it is impossible to study all the living organisms at a time. That means 1.7 to 1.1 millions of species we have. It is not easy to read all the organisms individually. So that means it is necessary to devise some means to make this possible. This process we call classification. That process is said to be as classification. We call it as classification. Okay. So what is classification? Classification is defined as the process by which anything is grouped into convenient categories based on some easily observable characters. If you observe that my pattern of teaching is not, I'm not coming from the first page to the second page to the third page, likewise I'm not coming. So I already explained the classification and various types of classifications that already explained. So that's why understanding these sentences is not going to be tough to you. We already made some convenient categories like kingdom, phylum, class, order, that family, genus and species. So if that things are in mind, it's so easy, you can understand easily, isn't it? So that's why the remaining, that major concepts we are already learned, just it's a formality now. We are going for some introductory areas of the textbook here. So that what is that? Classification is defined as a process which anything is grouped into convenient categories based on some easily observable character. The scientific term used for the categories is taxa. That to be remembered, the scientific term taxa, the taxa kingdom, the taxa phylum. Likewise, singular taxon, the taxon kingdom, taxon phylum. Likewise, the taxa can indicate categories at different levels, like animalia. Animalia is a category called kingdom, isn't it? Chordata, it is phylum. Mammalia, it is class. That represent taxa at different levels, I said, but we know all that levels because we learned it already. That kingdom and the phylum and class, order, family, genus, species. What do you say all of them as? Taxonomic categories. We call all them as taxonomic categories. Okay. Next, that hence based on certain specific characters, that all the living organisms can be classified into different taxa. All the living organisms can be classified into different taxa. This process of classification is called taxonomy. The study of external and internal structures, along with the structure of cell, developmental processes, ecological information of the organisms are essential, and they form the basis of modern taxonomic studies. So what to be remembered here? The modern taxonomic studies for the classification, what are required? What are required for the modern taxonomic studies? The modern taxonomic studies require that structure of cell, that means either it be prokaryotic or eukaryotic, developmental processes, ecological information of organisms, then all these are essential for the modern taxonomic study. Hence, the characterization, identification, nomenclature, classification are the processes that are basic to the taxonomy. What are basic to the taxonomy? Characteristics, identification, nomenclature, and classification are all said to be the processes that are basic to the taxonomy. Okay, moving on. Zoos as tools for classification. Zoos as tools for classification. So these are the places where wild animals taken out of their natural habitat are placed in protected environment under human care. Under human care, we say it as ex situ conservation. I have a separate chapter for these to learn all of them clearly. Just some definitions we are learning. That these are the places where wild animals taken out their natural habitat. That means we are bringing a tiger from the forest, and if you are putting in the zoo. So what is zoo? Zoo is the tools for classification. How that we'll see. But what do you say it as? Ex situ conservation. If the tigers are there in the forest and you are protecting them, we call it as in situ. Then when you bringing out into human habitats and you are protecting, we say ex situ. Okay. So that what is the advantage here enables us to learn about the animal's external feature, food habit. That means if we bring a particular tiger or lion or any animal. Okay, so if we bring them from that particular area, and if you are putting in a specific zoo, you can watch them, isn't it? Their external features, food habit, behavior, ethology, the behavioral characteristics. So that all you can observe, and you can place them in a specific category. That we say these observations enables us to systematize the organisms and positions in the animal world. Where should be placed? In which kingdom? In which phylum? Which class? Which order? Likely. In the same way, the museums are also helpful for us. Museums have biological specimens preserved in containers or jars in preservative solutions. That animal specimens may also be preserved as a dry specimen. That insects are preserved in insect boxes. Animal specimens, they are going to be preserved in the form of dry specimen. Insects are preserved in insect boxes. After collecting and killing, we pin them. We kill and pinning on the sheets. You can see there. Large animals like birds and mammals are usually stuffed. That means we remove that the internal stuff and we'll fill with cotton or something else. are preserved. So museums often have collections of the skeletons of animals. Okay, so properties of museums and zoos is given here. They are helpful for us in the form of a classification. So after that, biological classification. The living organisms exhibit a great deal of diversity due to variations in their structure and function. So far, we are that 1.25 million of animal species have been identified, and they are explained, they are described. So every species have their own diversity in the structure, in habitat, and modes of life. So to understand the interrelationship among the diversified animal groups, a systematic classification is must for us, because every species have their own unique properties. So the systematic classification is must for us. Various scientists have proposed their the proposals about the classification. So among them, that Carolus Linnaeus, which is said to be as father of taxonomy, and he is the founder of modern systematics. That Linnaeus is the father of taxonomy and founder of modern systematics. He introduced the system of hierarchical classification. Okay, so Linnaeus introduced the system of hierarchical classification. Like whatever we said, kingdom, class, that order, family, genus, species, all that. Phylum itself introduced by Haeckel, actually. That kingdom, class, order, family, what do you call the hierarchical classification? That was introduced by Linnaeus itself. Linnaeus is introduced this. Okay. So, the Linnaeus life period between 1707 to 1788, he considered as the father of taxonomy and the founder of modern systematics, which he introduced the system of hierarchical classification. And in the 19th and 20th century, numerical taxonomy and phylogenetic classification, that the two methods of classification that emerged. Numerical taxonomy and phylogenetic classification emerged in 19th and 20th century. Okay, let us see. We have some information about the phylogenetic or cladistic classification, which nowadays we are following. That phylogenetic or cladistic classification, that it is an evolutionary classification based on how a common ancestry was shared. The cladistic classification summarizes the genetic distance between all the species in the phylogenetic tree. Okay, so that a little bit a wise type of classification, we can say. That means we think that in numerical taxonomy there is no thinking, just we use to categorize. Like Aristotle, he just classified like that aquatile, volatilia, and terrestria. Okay, aquatile, volatilia, and terrestria. He just classified in that particular manner. Okay, we'll take a brief of that, and then after we'll come back here. We'll go with some examples that how does the cladistic classification was mentioned. That we'll go with some examples and then we'll talk about that. Okay. So cladistic classification, phylogenetic classification. So how it was made over. So for that we need to learn some kind of issues we need to see here. Some issues we need to follow through. Homology, analogy, divergent evolution, convergent evolution. So these kind of issues. Then let's go with simple terminology. Then after we'll go to the text here. Let's go with simple terminology. Let's take a bird. And we'll take mosquito. A bird, a mosquito, a bat. So what is common in this? The bird, a mosquito, in a bat. What is common Wings. Here? That Wings. All are living in one particular place, isn't it? The bird, mosquito, bat, all are living in one particular place. Okay. So then we'll take one more. Cockroach. Mosquito, that for that we should come from the beginning. So you are in first year, so if you take a brief, it will be helpful for us. For that I am going a small story here. Cockroach, mosquito, housefly, butterfly. So what is all the common among all these? These are all said to be insects, isn't it? All these are said to be insects. Cockroach, mosquito, housefly, butterfly, all these are insects. Okay. Like in the same way, we'll take one more. Human, whale, bat. So these are all said to be a category. Okay. So for this, we should go for a small story for this. Cockroach, mosquito, housefly, and butterfly. Millions of years back, the cockroach, mosquito, housefly, and butterfly, millions of years back, they used to live in one place. Then because of the heavy competition among these particular insects, what happened? They are migrated to the different places. Like means mosquito migrated to one particular place and started adapting to take the blood of human being. Housefly goes to the drainages. Butterfly went into the garden. Likewise, they shifted to different places. Okay, so that means mosquito, housefly, butterfly are shifted. For what? Due to the competition raised in between them. So, how do we recognize that? So, even mosquitoes, the food is blood. The housefly used to take liquid substances. And butterfly is used to collect nectar. The mouthparts are changed. No need to use the, remember the technical word, but I am using here. In case of mosquito, piercing and sucking type of mouthparts are present. Here in case of mosquito, piercing and sucking, that means to suck the blade, piercing and sucking type of mouthparts are present. Okay, in case of the housefly, the sponging and sucking type of mouthparts are present. Not getting? Let me write here. Yeah, sponging and sucking type of mouthparts are present. In case of butterfly, siphoning type of mouthparts are present. Siphoning, we use it to say. Siphoning type of mouthparts are present. That earlier, actually, all these are used to have a single type of mouthpart. What do you call that kind of mouthparts are? Biting and chewing type of mouthparts, which cockroach still having these kind of mouthparts. Biting and chewing type of mouthparts. But shifted to the different places and moved to the different kinds of food habits, that particular mosquito, housefly, butterfly, they get shifted into different places. That piercing and sucking type of mouthparts, sponging and sucking type of mouthparts, and siphoning type of mouthparts, they get changed like so. Though even they change, they have the basic mouthparts are same, like labrum, mandibles. That the previous the people who attended my class, at least they may know the names of these. That because we did little bit about cockroach also earlier. That maxillae, that labrum, labium, maxillae, hypopharynx. That no need to remember all these names and mouthpart types also. Just you should understand the concept exactly. That ancient times, what I said over the cockroach, mosquito, housefly, butterfly. All these are having similar kind of mouthparts, but time being, in the process of evolution, they get migrated to the different place. What do you say this as? We call this feature as divergent evolution. We say this feature as divergent evolution. Divergent, you see this, divergent. From one place to the different places, they are shifted. What do you say? Divergent evolution. Due to the divergent evolution, what can be expected here? Due to the divergent evolution results homology. Divergent evolution results homology. What is homology? Structural similarity, functional dissimilarity. That means the homology, which means structural similarity and functional dissimilarity. Functional dissimilarity, we can say. That means example what we said it now, that cockroach, mosquito, housefly, butterfly, all these are having this that structural similarity. So even they migrated to the same different places, they have the structural similarity, but functional dissimilarity. What we say functional dissimilarity? Mosquito is taking blood, housefly is taking liquid, and butterfly is collecting nectar. Cockroach still eating solid food material. So what do you say that is functional dissimilarity? Okay. But so even they are changed like so, the mouth parts are same. Labrum, labium, mandible, hypopharynx, likewise, the mouth parts are same. So that you need to remember the two definitions. The one is I visualized actually. The divergent evolution I just visualized for you. What is divergent evolution? From one place to the different places when the organisms are getting shifted over and adapted to their particular environment where they are living. What do you say that as divergent evolution? Okay. So though even they went over like that, just imagine in a family there are three brothers are there. So one went to Australia, one went to the Sri Lanka, and one went to the China. Oh my God. China, nowadays China. One went to the America, Australia, America, and Sri Lanka. Okay, so what do you call such kind of evolution? Divergent evolution, isn't it? So what kind of things can be expected over in them? Structural similarity. They look alike, at least a little bit, isn't it? Functional dissimilarity means they went to the different countries with their different jobs and different purposes. So that's why what do you say? You remember like that. You remember in that form, a family is there. That three brothers, A, B, C are there. So A went to the Australia and B went to the USA and C went to the New Zealand, something else. New Zealand. So he is a software engineer, he is a doctor, and he is a journalist. Whatever. Means function is different, jobs are different, functional dissimilarity. Structural similarity, because they're three brothers, isn't it? They look alike. If it is a movie, they completely look alike. Okay, but at least little similarity is enough to make us to say structural similarity, triple action of a hero. So what do you say? That is structural similarity. But doing different works, what do you say? Functional dissimilarity. So remember these two words, divergent and evolution and homology. We have separate explanation in our text in the coming days in organic evolution chapter also. But a basic pattern of classification, how do we do classify in that way? We are going for convergent evolution. The next one is convergent evolution. Convergent evolution. So which is related to the analogy. Okay, convergent evolution and analogy. Let us see about the convergent evolution and analogy. Okay, so then what is convergent evolution? Earlier we have taken example like a mosquito. Okay, next a bat and a bird. What is common in them? They are flying, isn't it? They are flying. All these are flying. Okay, so what is the similar here? Function is similar. Functional similarity. Okay, functional similarity. Okay, then structure. Can we say like that mosquito wing and bird wing is same? No, not at all. Then what do you say? Structural dissimilarity. Structural dissimilarity. Okay, structural dissimilarity and functional similarity. So how it has happened? Because from the different places, that to one place organisms are shown evolution. What do you say it as? Convergent. Remember the concept based on their meaning. Convergent. What is convergent? Converged. It means came together from different places. Came together. What do you say? Converged. Some 10 students or 20 students in the classroom came from different places and are joined in one class. So what do you call it as? Converged from different places. That convergent evolution. In the convergent evolution, you don't find any structural similarity. So what do you say? Structural dissimilarity, functional similar. So you need to remember in first year like this, convergent evolution leads to analogy. Convergent evolution leads to analogy. And what is analogy? That structural dissimilarity and functional similarity. Structural dissimilarity and functional similarity. So that you need to understand. Okay, next. Earlier, let's take up the previous one, the divergent evolution. Talking about the divergent evolution, this is divergent evolution. That means from one place to the different places, evolution happens, that various organisms are shifted to the different places. What do you call it as? The divergent evolution leads to homology. What is homology? Structural similarity and functional dissimilarity. Structural similarity and functional dissimilarity. Okay. So, let's take some more examples we are taken here. Bird, mosquito, bat, how we understand these? Yeah, this is convergent evolution. Convergent evolution. Such evolution we call the convergent evolution. That means from different places they came and migrated here. So, we call it as convergent evolution. Okay. Let me show you. Next, human, whale, bat. So what do you say it as? Human, whale, and bat.
Structural similar, but functional is different.
So what do you say? Homologous or analogous?
Homologous.
Homologous.
Homologous. You are saying structural similarity. Okay, what type of evolution they are shown?
Convert.
Divergent.
Divergent evolution.
Divergent.
Divergent. Very good. Human on land. Human is on land, isn't it? And whale is in water. Bat is in air. Very good. Very good. So human is on land. Whale is in water, bat is in air. So what do you say? That all they get shifted into different places. Different places. Shifted to different places. So that's why, what do you say this as? Divergent. Human on land, whale and bat. So they move to the different places. So that's why divergent evolution. So that means, what is similar to you with a bat or whale?
Hands.
Yeah, four limbs, we say. Okay, so technically we learn this in the second year in organic evolution chapter. You can say hands, okay. Hands. That means humerus, radius, ulna, carpals, metacarpals. What do you call them as? The particular the bones in them. That is common for us, both human whale and also with the bat also. So why we are learning this here? That means, the modern classification, what you said it as the phylogenetic classification, at the time when it is doing classification, it will consider these features also. It will consider these features also. What I mean, that little wise, type of classification it is. Means, though cockroach, mosquito, housefly, butterfly are present in the different places, so they are present in different places, that it doesn't mean like so, they are joined in different categories. No, we classify, we understand. They used to be in one place. Okay. And in the same way, nowadays you can see the mosquito, bat, bird are living in one place, in the air they are living. So that's why they are belongs to one phylum. Or they are belongs to one class. We don't say like that. We understand the pattern of evolution. Okay, because of convergent evolution, they came into one place. So that's why they are in one place. It doesn't mean so like they are belongs to same category. We should not understand in that particular manner. So that's why little bit information of evolution, organic evolution chapter, we came here and we learned. So by keeping these things in mind, we do the classification. While doing classification, what we'll do? We'll keep these things in mind. Okay, so now let's come back here to understand this phenomena. It is an evolutionary classification based on how a common ancestry was shared. I think you now you can understand what they are want to say. It is an evolutionary classification based on how a common ancestry was shared. And cladistic classification summarizes the genetic distance between all species in the phylogenetic tree. So what is phylogenetic tree? Phylogenetic tree, we can say like this. This is a kingdom. It contains many phyla. Okay, each phyla contain again many classes. Each class contain many order. So definitely it will come like a tree. Classification tree, we can say. So phylogenetic tree. Okay, so in cladistic classification, such as here it is, analogous characters. I think you know what is analogous now. Analogous, that means the organisms with a similar kind of function. Analogy means functional similarity, structural dissimilarity. Here in the text it was given example, wings in sparrow and wings in petachia, wing-like structures in the squirrel. Wing-like structures of the squirrel and wings of sparrow is given as an example in text here. So it is all happened because of what type of evolution? Convergent evolution. So we should remember analogy because of convergent evolution. And homology, the structural similarity and functional dissimilarity. Homologous character, the character shared by a pair of organism inherited from a common ancestor. Example is given, wings of sparrow and wings of finches are followed, taken into the consideration. So that homologous character, reason for the homologous characters, the type of evolution here, divergent evolution. Okay, so why we are saying all this here? Simply we are saying that at the time of doing, when we are doing the classification, if we consider the evolutionary characters of the organism, and that means that in a classroom, if some 10 children are there, so if it is a older classification, Aristotle type of classification, what he says, this 10 member or family belongs to one family or one class, I mean, easy to say. But we are not saying like that. How the 10 number are gathered here and what way they get gathered, because of convergent evolution. Okay, so even they gathered in one place, you can't say them as same family because they gathered here to listen the class. So they came from the different places. So that's why let us consider that also in the classification. In that manner, you need to understand. So why? The phylogenetic or cladistic classification means the wise classification. We consider that organisms, whether they are showing divergent or convergent evolution, homology and analogy. That's why human, whale, bat. Human is on land, whale is in water, and bat is in air. But all the three are joined in one class. What is that? Mammalian. Okay, next. Bird. A bird, if you take, and a mosquito, a bat. These three are living in the air. We doesn't classify that they are belongs to one category. Birds are there in air. Mosquito is in phylum Arthropoda class Insecta. Bat in Mammalia. Phylum Cardata class Mammalia. Means, though even they are living in one place, why you are not classifying in a single group? Means we'll give answer for that. What answer we'll give? They are showing convergent evolution. They came from the different places and staying here. So how can you say that? How can you prove that? Yeah, I can prove with the help of their analogy feature. They have the functional similarity, that but there is no structural similarity between the bird wing and mosquito wing. That you should understand in that manner. Okay, so even a small paragraph, it is complex because more topic that full discussion how to do in organic evolution. So simply in this area, you people need to understand, need to remember is, while doing cladistic classification, we consider divergent evolution, which leads to the homologous, convergent evolution, which leads to the analogous nature. That also we consider. Okay, finally, Ernst Haeckel introduced the method of representing phylogenic tree or branching diagram. Now I drawn the branching diagram. This is the kingdom, and kingdom having phylums. Phylum is having many classes. Classes are having many orders. Likewise, so that kind of phylogenic branching of tree is introduced by Haeckel. Haeckel introduced this kind of the phylogenic branching of a tree. Okay, so that's it about the phylogenetic or cladistic classification. Okay, so then next we'll continue. We continue with these. So we'll go with the levels and hierarchy of classification. Level and hierarchy of classification. I'll make it full screen. Yeah. Okay. Now let's come. The human beings are not only interested in knowing more about different kinds of organisms and their diversity, that but also the relationships among them. That this branch we call systematics. What is systematics? Systematics is a branch which that not only it explains the organisms and also it exhibits the diversity and the relationship between the organisms. Okay, systematics is a branch of science that deals, do remember, these are the properties. Systematics is a branch of science that deals with the vast diversity of life. That is number one, the vast diversity of life. It reveals the trends and evolutionary relationships between the organisms. Okay, so these relationships establish the phylogeny of organisms. And the third one, you remember, the key part of systematics is taxonomy. Okay, so what are the characteristics of systematics? Systematics, we said, systematic deals with the vast diversity of life. Systematic deals with the vast diversity of life. Okay, then the systematics deals with that you establish the relationships, the phylogeny of relationships, of the phylogeny of organisms. And the key part of systematics is taxonomy. This is the most important line you need to remember here. The key part of the systematics is taxonomy. That means taxonomy is also a part in systematics. Then taxonomic hierarchy includes 7 obligate categories. What are the 7 obligate categories? The kingdom, phylum, class, order, family, genus, species. That we have so many intermediate categories like subkingdom, grade, division, subdivision, subphylum, superclass, subclass, superorder, suborder, then superfamily, subfamily, subspecies. We have that so many other categories that what do you say all of them as intermediate categories. I ask you to remember that obligate categories, isn't it? That is kingdom, phylum, class, order, family, genus, and species. Okay, so then Linnaeus was the first taxonomist to establish a definite hierarchy of taxonomic categories. We call them as taxa. Singular, we say taxon. Taxa or taxon. Okay, then in his Linnaeus hierarchy, kingdom, class, order, genus, and species are there. That means what is means phylum. The phylum is introduced by Haeckel. Haeckel introduced the taxon phylum. Okay. A species sometimes may have more subspecies which show some morphological variation. I don't want to reveal this back again. We took half an hour time in the crow story. Did you remember the crow story? The crow of India, crow of Sri Lanka, crow of Myanmar, due to geographical isolation, they got morphological variation, which leads to the taxonomic category lower than the species. What do you say? Subspecies. How it is formed? We discussed earlier. Okay. Then taxonomic categories. Nowadays, 3 domain classification is followed. What is domain? Which is more than the kingdom, bigger than the kingdom. That Carl Woos and co-workers observed that many prokaryotes previously classified under prokaryota or monera, which are more closely related to the eukaryotes, and classified them under a separate domain called archaea. Okay, Okay, so we need to understand this line. Karl Woos and co-workers observed that many prokaryotes, which are previously classified into kingdom Monera, that means let's take some prokaryotes which are actually joined in Monera, which are actually joined in kingdom Monera, but they have more closely related to the eukaryote, the domain eukaryote, more closely related to the domain eukarya. So that's why they created a separate domain for them, that is archaea. Okay, for that you people need to know there are two domains actually. What are the two domains? That one is prokarya and other is eukarya. Then prokarya and eukarya, but a third domain is also created, that is archaea, because that some prokaryotes which are less similar with the Monera having more similarities with eukarya, even you can't join in them, that well, that's why we created three domains. Totally how many domains are present at present? Means three domains. So this type of study, what do you say? Molecular systematics. This type of study we say molecular systematics. Okay, so let me say you that actually we don't have this much information. Let me say you, so what is domain? Domain means the bigger than the kingdom. Okay, so what exactly they want to say, there are two domains, prokarya and eukarya. Okay, eukarya. Okay, prokarya and eukarya. What is prokaryote? Prokaryon. Yon means spelling will change. Prokaryon. Prokaryon means that nuclear membrane is absent. Eukaryon means distinct nucleus is present. In the prokaryon, which is considered as Monera, that some of the prokaryotes are having more similarities with the eukaryotes than the prokaryotes. That's why with them we made a new domain, that is archaea. With that came with a new domain that is called archaea. So with that, how many domains it became now? Three domains. Okay, so domain knowledge is not at all helpful for us in need, just for formality given in the state textbook, that we are talking about them. Then this kind of study we call it as molecular systematics. We say this kind of study as molecular systematics. Okay, of the domain. Now with this we say there are three domain classification of the living organisms. Now you say domain 1 bacteria, that means prokarya. Domain 2 is archaea. Domain 3 is eukarya. Okay, so what is the domain? Domain is a taxon higher than the kingdom. So bacteria and archaea represent two separate distinct groups. What do you call domain? So the modern taxonomists replace the kingdom Monera with two distinct kingdoms, that is bacteria and archaebacteria. Details will get in a chapter called biological classification in botany. The studies on RNA revealed that archaea and eukarya are more closely related. Archaea and eukarya are more closely related to each other than the prokarya, that is nothing but bacteria. According to three domain system, there are six kingdoms, namely bacteria, archaebacteria, protista, plantae, fungi and animalia. Okay, so that this classification is explaining that there are three domains and six kingdoms. And remember, no way it will be helpful for you in the case of NEET here, but because according to the NEET we have a separate chapter, that in that chapter we have only five kingdoms: kingdom Monera, protista, fungi, plantae and animalia. Biological classification, the chapter is. But we have a classification, that three domain classification, which gives six kingdom classification, six kingdoms. Because that thing we said it out, that a separate group called archaea, domain 3, archaea, is more closely related with the eukarya than the bacteria. Bacteria nothing but prokarya. Okay, so just for general knowledge aspect, we learn this paragraph. Okay, don't get too much worry about that, because when you go to the botany, when botanist says that there are 5 kingdoms: kingdom Monera, Protista, Fungi, Plant, Animalia. In kingdom Monera, Archaea is there, diatoms are there, rhinoflagellate. When they start saying, you should not ask him, sir, there are 6 kingdoms, so you are saying wrong. You should not say like that. That's why, as an information aspect, the given in text here, that no way this kind of information helpful for us in NEET, because this paragraph is not there in NCERT text. Okay. Okay, now let's come through this. We discussed all these: kingdom, phylum, class, order, family, genus, species. We discussed all these. The only thing we need to discuss here, with our learned information, we have seen human hierarchy, isn't it? That Hominoidea. Okay, I'm asking you, what is Hominoidea? What is Hominoidea? Yes, what is that? Hominoidea.
Family. Superfamily.
Superfamily. Very good.
It's family.
Hominoidea. Hominidae.
Subfamily.
Subfamily, sir.
Let me ask the question. Hominidae. What is Hominidae?
Family, sir.
Family. Very good. Hominine.
Subfamily.
Subfamily.
Yeah.
Subfamily.
Subfamily. With that, we are learning some basic information that Idea means the suffix. Ide is the suffix. Ine is the suffix. Suffix, I think you know, in English we have suffix and prefix. Prefix means this is prefix, which is in the beginning. Suffix means in the ending. So now I am asking the question here. What is the suffix of superfamily? Suffix of superfamily. Idea.
Idea, sir.
The suffix of family. Ide.
Ide, sir.
Suffix of subfamily. Ine. You should say ine. Okay. So let me write. Close this bigger screen and let me write. So what I am saying, idea, ide, ine. The suffix of superfamily is idea. The suffix of family is ide. And suffix of subfamily is ine. And the prefix for all this. Who is the prefix for all these? Homo, which is Homo. Nothing but the name of the genus. That means for genus name, if we add suffix idea, Hominoidea, that is superfamily. For genus name, if we add the suffix called ide, Hominidae, that is family. For the suffix ine, if we add the genus name, that Hominine, that is subfamily. So you need to understand in that particular manner. So let me read that supporting statements which are given here. Supporting statements which are given. Here it is. Adding the suffix ide to the type of generic name forms the name of the family. Adding the suffix ide to the type of generic name homo gives the name of the family to which man belongs to, that is Hominidae. The name of the subfamily can be coined by the adding suffix ine to the type of generic name, that Hominine, and the name of the superfamily by adding the suffix idea to the generic name. Generic name is Homo. For Homo, if we add idea, that becomes superfamily. If we add ide, that becomes family. If we add ine, that becomes subfamily. That he want to say. Okay. The remaining information we discussed in detail, that we made some notes even there. That many that the species belongs to the genus, many genus belongs to the family, and many families are belongs to the order, and many orders are belongs to the class, and many classes are belongs to the phylum, and many phyla are belongs to the kingdom. Okay, so that we are completed earlier. So the finally after that we came through this also. A species may include subspecies. That subspecies, how they get formed, we learned in the form of story. That crow story, geographical isolation with morphological variation, and the nomenclature patterns we are seeing, the binomial nomenclature are completely seen over. Trinomial nomenclature we learned, the tatonymy. I'm giving a conclusion here. The tatonymy, Then concept of species. We discussed the concept of species, and finally after that concept of species, you know, interbreeding in general possible between the two different species. But if at all very closely related species of one genus, when they interbreed, we have an example here. A hybrid can be formed over kinni. Kinni is formed by two different species, a cross between a female donkey and a male horse, gives rise to the sterile offspring. That is sterile. Why? Because the donkey and horse equus caballus equus asinus, they belong to the different species. Okay, so that's it about the concept of species. We discussed earlier actually that some issues we are talking now. Diversity of living world. Almost we are completed the diversity of living world. People in between the time, if you miss the classes, so see here. I'm showing that YouTube. You have to go to the YouTube, and else I'll send the link also to you. So what we need to do, just type in the YouTube search Neet Srikanth. Neet Srikanth. Okay, so when you search like this, Neet Srikanth, my photograph will come. You click on the photograph. Okay, so there we have playlist. In the playlist, go to the diversity of the living world, and Kingdom Animalia series is given separately. Those who missed the Kingdom Animalia series, they have to go there, and diversity of living world. So if you click here, the diversity of living world, that you will get the videos like this. I think this is yesterday's class, the taxonomy hierarchy. Okay, you'll get like this. The series of that videos of diversity of living world will come for you to revise these particular chapters, everything, concept of species, the branches of zoology, that whatever we learned till the time, that all will come. Okay. Okay, and here you see there is my photograph actually here. So if you click on that photograph, you will get the subscribe button. Just subscribe. If you subscribe, you'll get day by day videos which I am uploading, you'll get. Okay. So that's it.